Good morning, St. B.
Good morning.
We have the following announcements. January 9th, the United Women of Faith and Dora Circle meeting will be at 10:30 a.m. On January 10th, there will be no Bible study. On January 12th, the United Women of Faith Night Group Circle meeting will be at 6:30 p.m. Upper rooms, you can pick up a copy at either sanctuary entrance to guide your daily devotional. The end of year giving statements for 2023 will be sent out after January 21st. As we begin the new year, please review the prayer list at the top of the back of the bulletin. If you have someone to add or wish to remain on the prayer list, please contact the church office, and the email address is on the bulletin. And attendance, as always, please fill out your attendance pad to let us know that you were with us in worship today.
Good morning and welcome. Corrie, unfortunately, is under the weather, and she called me yesterday, so we will not be having communion today. It's kind of a last minute thing, and you're stuck with me today. So, but good morning and welcome, and like he said, please sign in, and we're glad you're here. And can you believe it's 2024? Please join me in the greeting this morning. The Magi had a dream.
They dreamed of the
Messiah. They dreamed of just rulers. They dreamed of a new day for all people. The Magi had a dream, and this dream led them to action.
They journeyed to unknown places. They followed a star. They walked for days.
So, may we be like the Magi. May our dreams inspire action. May we worship the one true God. Amen. Now, if you're able, if you please stand and we will sing We Three Kings, page 254, or it's on the overhead. And remain standing for the affirmation of faith and the glory of Patra.
Thank you.
living God, who came to this earth as a child, was born to unmarried teenage parents, and was quickly made a refugee. We believe that this child grew up to heal the sick, see the poor, dine with outcasts, welcome foreigners, wash the feet of sinners, offer second chances, and bless the children. And so we believe that Christmas is only the beginning. The dream does not end with a manger. The dream ends with God's promised day. So until all God's children are home, we will follow the Magi's lead, walking, seeking, and looking up. May it be so, for this we believe. Amen.
Let us pray. God of the Milky Way, we, like the Magi, are walking toward you, one foot in front of the other. We are walking toward you. It is our very prayer to move your way. So if you can, leave the light on and the front door unlocked. Leave a fire in the hearth and food on the stove. And when we start to get lost or doubt our dreams, give us the will to persevere. We are walking toward you, O God. So like the parent that throws open the door to us through this text. Amen.
From Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 6. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may remain seated, and we're going to sing hymn number 2095 and the Faith We Sing, Star Child. And it's going to be sung with the CD.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able for a reading of the Gospel of St. Matthew. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Welcome, friends. We made it. Welcome to 2024. With the dawn of the new year, we both reflect on the year we just lived through and look forward to hopes and opportunities that come with the new year. Some of you may have made New Year's resolutions, and last Sunday we were given a star that had, it was star words, and on the back of that star were these words to ponder on and to meditate on for the new year. And we might have even had an epiphany or two for this year. Today marks the end of a journey, our journey through Advent and Christmas, and we have reflected on those, on who we are as dreamers, living into God's dream for our world and the manifestation of those dreams through Jesus. Though this season is ending, the good news of Christ is eternal, and it is good news for all people. On this Epiphany Sunday, we celebrate how God's love transverses cultural and geographical barriers to become good news for all people. This morning we journey with the Magi as they follow the star to locate the newborn Christ. You just heard it read in the scripture. Just about the time Jesus was born, there was a strange feeling in the world, an expectation of the coming of a king. It was in the air. We build up to that, to build up to Christmas through Advent and the coming of a king. The Holy Spirit was moving in mighty ways, and God was about to break into this world. Even the Roman historians felt the vibes, and they wrote about them. Heard in Isaiah, the reading of Isaiah this morning. So, when King Herod found out that the wise men had come from the east, and that they were searching for a little child who had been born to be king of the Jews, You know, any king would have been worried. But Herod was doubly distraught. You see, Herod had a heavy duty flaw in his character. He was insanely suspicious. And the older he got, the worse he got. He became worse as he got older. He was, as someone said, a murderous old man. If he thought anyone might be a rival to his power, well, that person was immediately killed. You know, he even murdered his wife and his brother, or her brother. He killed his oldest son and his two other sons. Augustus, the Roman emperor, had said bitterly, "It's safer to be Herod's pig than to be Herod's son." So how would such a guy feel when the news got to him that a child was born who was destined to be the king? Well, Herod called the Magi secretly, and he found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child." He said he wanted to be able to go and worship Christ, but of course, he was determined to kill the one who might dethrone him. The birth of God into the world set off a firestorm of political dynamite. See, Herod was afraid that this little child was going to interfere with his life, with his place, with his power and his influence, and therefore, his first instinct was to destroy him. There are those, still those who might gladly destroy Jesus Christ because they see in him the one who interferes with their lives, one who threatens to dethrone them. For in order to follow Christ, we must die with Christ. Of course, in dying with Christ, we are raised to new life in Christ and with Christ. We willingly move our fannies off the thrones to allow Jesus Christ, our true King, to take the reins. And there's nothing more exciting than that. But at the same time, there's nothing more intimidating. See, to give up control of our own lives is a scary thing. To sell all we have in order to follow Christ takes a lot of humility. And it certainly takes maturity. There's a selflessness which is the beginning of all wisdom and life. It's real life where we are really living. There is nothing wiser and nothing more real, nothing more human than to die to self and live for God and for others. There's nothing which can bring us peace, happiness, and great satisfaction. And of course, it also goes against our greatest instincts. See, we're humans, we're human beings, and we have a great survival instinct. And it's gotten us where we are so far. It's gotten us this far, but it also has gotten us in trouble. Herod wanted to survive, and this is the clash that shakes all of our history. Herod had money and magnificence, but Christ was born in a manger, in a lowly, dirty stable where cows and sheep have been. Herod was big and strong, but Christ came in as a helpless baby. Herod had power and he used it in very cruel ways. Christ had compassion and mercy and humility and love. Herod was great in the eyes of the world, and Christ was seemingly weak, but divine, for whom and through whom all things are created. Herod tried to cut down others for the sake of himself, but Jesus Christ let himself be cut down for the sake of others. God's ways are not always our ways. See, our ways as human beings are flawed. We're sinners. And we lead people to hurt or pain or evil intent and sometimes ultimate destruction. We are a fallen, broken, and incomplete people without Christ. Therefore, we must trust in Christ as our guide. We must allow God to sit on the throne of our lives. We must set ourselves aside and allow Christ to be in control. There's no other way. Herod, who had been designated the king of the Jews by the Romans, felt threatened by Jesus. Herod told the Magi, "As soon as you find Jesus, report to me so that I may go and worship him." Yeah. Well, the Magi followed Herod's instructions and were told that on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him and brought him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then the Magi were warned in a dream not to go back to Herod. For if Herod knew where Jesus was, he certainly would have sent an army to kill and to do away with Jesus. That's a terrible situation the Magi find themselves in. The Magi refer to Jesus as the King of the Jews. See, Jesus is not their king. They do not share a cultural or religious tradition with Jesus, and yet somehow they recognized Jesus' power and come to pay homage to him. Are they going to obey Herod, or are they going to obey God? The Magi chose to return to their country by a different route. This is the language of conversion. This is the language of changed lives. The decision to follow Christ and forsake Herod. The decision to die to self and live and be with God. And this is a conundrum or a difficult situation that a lot of times we find ourselves in each and every day. Do we listen to them or do we follow Christ? As Christians today, We do not necessarily share in the cultural or religious traditions of Jesus. We're not Jewish, and we don't live in the Middle East, and we live in an entirely different time. And yet we recognize that Christ's power in the world is still there, and we still come to pay homage to Christ. It's easy to feel endangered by who Jesus is as we continue to discern and to live into the practice that Christ wants us to live. The divine taking on human flesh and the form was a very political dynamite, and it still is. God is invading a fallen world through the birth of Christ. God is breaking through the gates of hell. The kingdom is coming to earth, and its doors are open to all who want to come through. When Christ was born, his life clashed with the house of Herod, who did not take kindly to the idea of someone else claiming to be the king of the Jews. The political stakes were high. Those scrambling for worldly power were shaken. Herod sent representatives to spy on him. And eventually, Jesus would come face to face with the representative of the world's greatest king, Pilate, who was Caesar's subordinate. Just in a few short weeks, we will be entering the Lenten season. Can you believe it? February the 14th is Ash Wednesday. That's just a few weeks away. Pilate had rather different gifts to give to Jesus. Although Pilate, too, was warned in a dream not to do anything to harm him. Pilate's soldiers were the first Gentiles since the Magi to call Jesus King of the Jews. But the crown they gave him was made of thorns, and his throne was the cross. At that moment, instead of a bright star, there was an unearthly darkness out of which we hear a single soldier's voice say, "Yes, he really was God's son." We have entered the year of 2024. It's a new year full of possibilities, of hope, joy, peace, and love. And we join in the generations of those who have strived for ideals across the world. The truth of Christ among us has not changed. The truth of the power of Christ has not changed. The truth that we are called to honor and follow in Christ's footsteps has not changed. The Bible has not changed. The truth of Christ is that the birth of God's Messiah is a sign to the world for healing and for life, not for terror and death. The light of Christ has come. It's been recognized. We still see the lights. We join with the generations of those before us as we continue to strive for a church and world that fully lives into the truth of the birth of Jesus Christ. The divine has come, and God has made us bearers of the truth and light. So may we go forward with confidence of those called by God to speak the good news and shine our light for others. Shine the light of Jesus Christ for others. Let us follow the light of God's star. The choice is ours. The gift is of God. Amen. At this time, if our ushers would come forward, we will take up our morning offering. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we bring our gifts to you. We give generously to this church in your name so we can share the light of Christ for others. Amen. Our joys and its concerns this morning. Do you, any of you have any joys or concerns you'd like to share?
Jen? My oldest grandson made the straight A honor roll. He's a sixth grader, so
Wonderful. Yeah. Yay. We do appreciate the young people that make the honor rolls and so forth. And I want to say thank you to the girls this morning for playing for us. And we're going to play at the post. Sophia's playing at the postlude too, so I do appreciate that. Thank you. Others. I want to let you know that Dorothy Burney, Corrie did go to see her on Wednesday, took communion to her, and she knew her. And after her stroke about three weeks at least, they are bringing her back to Clarksville, I think the 10th, which is 3 days from now or something. Don't know yet what nursing home or rehab. They didn't have the place of the rehab yet when she talked to Debbie the other day, unless somebody else has heard Anita. Also, Doyle, we're glad to have you back with us. Doyle has spent some time this week, not doing very well. Doyle's been in the hospital. Appreciate you being here this morning. And I know Doyle's not out of the woods yet. He is still having to take some IV at home, a bacterial infection that caused an abscess. And he's still going through treatment. So we're glad you're here. Take care of yourself. Otherwise, we do have our prayer list on the back of the bulletin. If you have any, know of any others. Randy was planning to come today. Randy Boyer is home from the rehab, or from the FEA home. He is back at his house. He was planning to come today, and he called me about 7 o'clock and said he wasn't feeling very well. So Randy didn't come today, so I was going to go pick him up. But he is home and has been doing much better, so keep him in prayer, too. And keep Corrie, obviously, in prayer. She did test positive for COVID yesterday. Sarah?
One of my four coworkers who was going to give birth this year, she gave birth at 30 weeks and one day on January 2nd because there were complications with her baby girl. But both mom and baby are doing okay. We fully expect that the baby girl is going to be in the hospital for quite a while, being born that early. But they said she's breathing on her own, which is fantastic for being born that early.
Wonderful. Sarah has a coworker that was only 30 weeks with her pregnancy and had her baby girl. And they are both doing okay. The baby's breathing on her own. I have a great niece that had a baby on the 29th of December. That was early. Her baby wasn't due until January 19th, but she'd been having problems with blood pressure. They went home. But she was back in the hospital this week because of blood pressure problems, but they're doing fine. They're doing good. So they're in Joplin, Missouri. I will add my daughter on the prayer list, Teresa Adkins. She's going through some heart issues, and so she's too young to be doing that, but obviously we don't have that choice sometimes, and prayers for her would be appreciated. Anybody else? Let us go to God in prayer. Dear God, Lord of the bright and abiding light, you have shown us in the person of Jesus, your Son, a new way to live. You have poured your light into the world and asked us to live in the light rather than run and hide in the darkness of doubt and despair. You promised to be our light all of our days and asked us to place our trust in you The journey in this light is risky. It means that we must be very serious about our service to you, Lord. Giving you our best and offering hope and light to others. In this new year, we bring to you the names and the situations of others for whom light seems to be a stranger. Some struggle with ill health, some with economic hardship, or broken and damaged relationships, loss of loved ones, and anxiety and hunger. We place them in your care, Lord. Let your light shine on them and bring healing and hope, and help us to be bearers of that light in all that we do. Through taking meals, through our fuel program, through our closet, through just a smile or a visit at the homes. And we ask this in Jesus' name. And now, Lord, be with each of us as we pray together the prayer that you first taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies. This is on page 173 in the hymnal, and it will be on the overhead. So if you would please stand as you are able, page 173. Okay, we go forth into the world, not knowing what trials of life may await us in our life. Let us not be dismayed, for our Heavenly Father has promised to strengthen and uphold us by the right hand of his power. Farewell.